Hello and welcome to Storytime at 9. And today, as Siddhi has said now in the comments, we are traveling to virtual Australia with one of the finest storytellers, Jackie Kerin. For those who are joining us for the first time, every Saturday we travel to different countries with the finest storytellers from that country who will be telling us stories from their country and also introducing us to their culture. And we did it for one season, 7 months. Now we are back with the second season. All the previous videos are there on YouTube and Facebook for that, for you to check out if you've missed any of them. And today is also a special day because not only do we have a wonderful storyteller who is going to introduce a new form of storytelling to us, which is Kamishibai. She'll tell you more about it, right? But other than that, today we begin our first feature of Tiny Tellers, Mighty Tales. Now, for those of you who do not know what that means, in the first episode of season 2 with Nupur, we announced that we are adding a new feature in Storytime at 9, in which every Saturday we'll have a storyteller from a different country, a master storyteller. But along with that, we will feature a storytelling video by a child, by one of the viewers. And this we did, and we called that initiative what? Tiny Tellers, Mighty Tales. And this is in partnership with certain schools which have been promoting our sessions, which have been partnering with us for Storytime at 9. And we asked schools to select storytelling videos from children from classes 2 to 7 and send us 3 videos. Now, some of them have sent us. Many of them have sent us. We have some of them, we have gone back to them saying that, you know, we want some changes in the videos. Like, for example, we had said the time for each video must be 5 minutes to 7 minutes only. Not less than 5 minutes, not more than 7 minutes. The other thing we had said is each of the videos has to be a retelling of a story told in Storytime at 9, right? So in cases where it did not match, we have asked them to resend. But we have some schools today. And what we'll do every time, including today, is we'll have a lottery. Now, we don't know which school is going to be featured today. Okay. So every school that is partnering with us, that is sending us videos, we will have a storytelling video by a child from that school played on one of the Saturdays. Okay. But which Saturday that is, it'll be a lottery that will decide. Now, which of the 3 videos that has come from the school will be played? That will be a second lottery that will again decide. Right. So let us see which school is coming up today. So what schools do we have? Let me read out the names. For the first episode, the schools in the lottery are Baksi Jagabandhu English Medium School 1, BJEMS 2, Mothers Public School Unit 1, DAV Pokhariport, and DAV Chandrasekharpur. Now let us see which school wins the lottery for today. Now the school that does not win today, they will have the chance on another Saturday, right? So which school is it today? Can we play the lottery? Now, who is it? Who is it? Wow, so it is BJEMS 2, BJB English Medium School 2. Now we don't know, which of the videos from there will be played today, that we don't know. But yes, let's see. About Loyola, I talked to father, since some of you are asking. So father said that probably the school will participate after school reopens. So which is fine. You know, we'll wait for that. And for those of you, you're not sure if your school is participating or not, why don't you request your school to partner with us? And what they need to do is they need to write to us at Contact Bakul. You know our email ID, right? They need to write to us requesting that they be a part of this, right? So, but now let us move on with the show. And today, as I said, we have a wonderful storyteller, Jackie Kerin. And Jackie Kerin is going to tell us stories using this wonderful form of Kamishibai. So Jackie, over to you now. Please tell us your stories, but first, please tell us a little more about Kamishibai. Over to you.
Nah. hello to everybody who's watching, to all my old friends in India, and to all my new friends. I'll have new friends after this. So something about Kamishibai. Well, yes, it is a Japanese way of telling stories, and obviously I'm not Japanese. So if you really want to see the experts, I suggest you have a look at some of the Japanese storytellers telling the stories. But it's a form of storytelling that has become popular all over the world. In fact, we've had our very first world Kamishibai forum where people from all different countries, different languages have been sharing Kamishibai. So let me hold this card up there. See, oops, there it is. You can see how it's spelt. Kami. Oops, over there. Kami means paper, and shibai means theater or drama. And the reason you can see a bicycle there is because way back in the 1930s and 40s in Japan, the stories were told from the back of a bicycle. The storytellers would pedal around the streets, find somewhere to set up their bicycle and tell their stories. There's nothing on the bike. Hang on, I'll show you. Oops, there it is. There you can see the storyteller there has a stage on the bike that pops up, very similar to the one I'll be using. And inside that stage, there are story cards, pictures. Now, all the stories I'm going to tell you today, the pictures have been made by me. I'm not a fantastic artist or anything. I just have a go, and I'm hoping, I'll just put those down there. I'm hoping that after you've seen me tell some Kamishibai stories and jokes and riddles, that you might be inspired to have a go. So here's my Kamishibai story. Storytelling box. This one was made for me by a very, very good friend, and it's made from Australian gum tree, so it really is an Aussie Kamishibai. Oh no, that's interesting. I just said Aussie, short for Australia. Yeah, that's where I am. But Australia is a big country. Let's have a look. Where exactly am I? Can you see that? That arrow is pointing to my city, Melbourne, down here. You can see Australia is divided into states and territories, like India, and all these states and territories have big cities in them. And this is my city down here, Melbourne. So that's right where I am right now, on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation, telling you some stories. Now, all the stories I'll be telling you have animals in them. I love animals. And in Australia, we love our unique Australian animals, animals that you don't find anywhere else in the world. And I'm going to share one with you right now. This animal lives in a burrow. What animals?
There is some problem that is happening with Jackie. We'll just give me 1 second. We'll just get back to her again.
Rabbit? Yeah, rabbits live in burrows. Oh, we've got rabbits here, all right. But rabbits are not Australian animals. They were brought here by the colonists. No, inside this burrow, let me see. You might not know this one. We know it very well, but if you come from another country, you might not be so familiar with it. Let's have a look. There it is. Shh. We don't want to frighten it because it's a wild animal. It's called a wombat. Wombat. W-O-M-B-A-T. It's quite much bigger than a rabbit, about as big as a small coffee table. You know, it digs very complicated burrows with multiple entrances. I'm just going to put him away there. There we go. Let him go back to sleep. Let's have a look here. Here's another one. This animal lives in a hollow in an old tree. What animal would live in a hollow in an old gum tree? Has to be a very old tree to have a nice big hollow for this animal. Oh, I think some of you have guessed already. This animal. Here it is. Is an owl. This is an Australian barn owl. And even though I live in the city, we sometimes have barn owls. So, let's get on with the first story. And this story has quite a few animals in it. Let's see how many there are and how many you know. See if you can guess as we go along. This is a garden. This is Molly's garden. Molly likes to grow vegetables. So do I. I like to grow vegetables in my garden as well. Here she's growing tomatoes, sweet corn, peas and beans. But one morning, Molly went out into the garden and she could hear munch, munch, munch. Munch, munch, munch. Munch, munch, munch. There was someone eating her vegetables. Do you know who it was? See if you can guess. Oh, look, there he is. It was Kangaroo. Molly couldn't believe her eyes. Kangaroo, Kangaroo, what are you doing? Eating all the vegetables. I'm growing them. I'm going to share them with my friends. We're going to have a picnic. But did Kangaroo listen? No. He went right on munching. Munch, 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 munch. And then he did what kangaroos sometimes do. He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. Oh, no. And he sent Molly flying over the fence. Whee! Oh, oh dear. Well, Molly's friend, I wonder if you can guess who's Molly's friend. Let's have a look. Can you guess this Australian animal? It's koala. Koala went and had a word with kangaroo. Kangaroo, could you please stop eating all Molly's vegetables? They're for all of us to share. We're going to have a picnic. Did kangaroo listen? No. He went right on munch, 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 munching. Oh, kangaroo, please stop eating all the vegetables. There won't be any left. And then kangaroo did what kangaroos sometimes do. He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. He sent koala flying over the fence. Whee! Oh. Oh, dear. Then Molly's friend, who is this friend? I'll give you a clue. It's a big bird, not a turkey, not a peacock, much, 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 much bigger than those birds. Ostrich? No. No, ostriches aren't Australian animals. This is an Australian emu. Oh, when emu went into the garden, couldn't see kangaroo anywhere. But emu could hear kangaroo. Munch, 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 munch. Kangaroo! Kangaroo, I can hear you. Where are you? Kangaroo! And then suddenly, up pop kangaroo's head over the tomatoes. Oh, kangaroo, would you please stop eating all Molly's vegetables? They're for all of us to share. We're going to have a picnic. Did kangaroo listen? He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. He rocked back on his tail. Oh, no! And he sent emu flying over the fence, feathers everywhere. Oh, so now Molly and her friends were all on the wrong side of the fence. But someone had been watching all this. Do you know who this is? Maybe you have a similar bird where you are. This is an Australian magpie, and it has the most beautiful song. It really is. I'll see if I can do it for you. It goes. I'm not as good as the magpie, but something like that. Magpie looked at Molly and her friends and said, "What's going on? What's happened to you lot? Why aren't you working in the garden?" "Oh, you know, Magpie, kangaroo's in there and he's eating all the vegetables. There won't be anything left for the picnic." "Ah, well, I'll go and have a word to kangaroo and see what he says." Oh, so Magpie flew off and then did what magpies sometimes do, and they really do this. Magpie swooped down over kangaroo's head. Kangaroo felt the clack of its beak and the whoosh of its wings. Whoosh, clack. Whoosh, clack. And when Magpie had kangaroo's full and undivided attention, he gave him a bit of a talking to. Oh dear. Oh dear. When kangaroo heard how he'd been upsetting Molly and her friends, he felt absolutely terrible. Oh, he was so sorry he'd been so mean. He knew what he had to do. He had to apologize. And he did. He apologized from his heart. He really, really was sorry. So then Molly and all her friends set about planning their picnic. Oh, all the things they were going to eat from the garden. They were going to eat tomatoes, sweet corn, peas, and beans. And that's the story of Molly and her garden. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you enjoyed those animals. Ah, but there's more than just stories you can tell with a Kamishibai. You can make jokes like this one. I love these. Perhaps you've done some of these yourself. What do you get when you cross a cat and an octopus? Do you get a cat with an octopus's body, like with a cat's head and then the octopus's body? Or do you get an octopus's head with a cat's body. What do you think? Drum roll. Well, in my imagination, this is what you get. I think it's maybe it's an octo cat. I'm not sure. Let's see what else is in here. Ah, this is another one of my favorite stories that also has at least one Australian animal in it. It's the story of Split Dog. That's a funny name for a dog, isn't it? Split Dog. Well, let me tell you, Split Dog wasn't always called Split Dog. He used to have a perfectly sensible name. His name was Dog. Well, I think that's sensible. I mean, you wouldn't call a dog Giraffe, for example. I mean, that would just be plain confusing. This is a story of how Dog became Split Dog. You ready? Let me show you a dog. There he is. Ah, there he is. This is Dog before he became Split Dog. You can see he's very, very handsome and he was very intelligent. Belonged to an old man who I only know by the name of Old Joe. Let me tell you, Old Joe, well, you know, he's a bit of a daydreamer, a bit like me, possibly like you as well. Anyway, one day Dog and Old Joe were out hunting. There you can see Old Joe's boot prints, you can see Dog's paw prints, and you can see the animal they're hunting. What could that possibly be? Have any of you guessed? Ooh, I think some of you have. It was a kangaroo, of course, a great big, big kangaroo, enormous. We call them boomers. Oh, and this boomer, oh, it did not want to be caught. I mean, would you? Oh, so off it went, boing to the right. So Dog went to the right, to the left, boing, to the right, boing, to the left, boing, 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 and then boing. It went behind a big old gum tree. Now, Dog didn't know which way to go. Should it go to the right or should it go to the left? Left, right, left, right. Do you know which way Dog went? Can you guess? Did Dog go left or did Dog go right? Well, let me tell you, no. He didn't go left or right. No. He actually went both ways at the same time. This is a cautionary tale. You should always make up your mind whether or not you want to go right or left, because this is what happened. Old Joe couldn't believe his eyes. Oh, no, crikey, what's happened to me dog? Oh, no, he's gone and split himself in two. He was a perfectly good dog. What am I going to do? Old Joe had a thought. He always kept a piece of chewing gum behind his ear. I know that's a bit disgusting, but anyway, that's what he did. He popped it in his mouth. He chewed it up till it was good and sticky. Then he got the two halves of Dog, the right half and the left half, and he stuck him back together again. Oh, but I did tell you old Joe was a bit of a daydreamer, didn't I? And this is what happened. Oh, no. Crikey. What have I gone and done to me dog? I've gone and stuck him all topsy-turvy. He's two legs up and two legs down. Oh, no. I know what I'll do. I'll just change his name. I'll call you Split Dog from now on. So that's how Dog got his name. That's how he became Split Dog. And he gets around like this. And he can go really quite fast if he wants to. So if ever you come to Melbourne, Australia, and visit me, and you see a dog getting around like this, you'll know it's Split Dog. There. Now, old Joe and Split Dog, they had many, many adventures. And this is adventure number one. Oh, no, it's not. No, it's not adventure number one. Sorry about that. We can't do adventure number one until you've solved the puzzle. So this is what you have to do. You have to add these sounds together. This is pie. You have to add the TH, which in English is th. So pie plus th, pith. And you can see there, the arrow is pointing to on. So you have to add pie plus on. What do you think it would be? I think some of you have got it already. Oh, some of you are still scratching your heads. Drum roll. I've got to get the card ready so I can do the dramatic reveal. Here we go. Drum roll. Python. Did you get that? Pi plus th plus on. Python. Okay. So now can we do? We can. Adventure number one. One of my favorite Split Dog adventures. Split Dog and old Joe, they were camping. In Australia, people like to go camping in a tent, out in the bush, under the stars. And there they are at a place just north of Yakandanda, east of Mullingandra and south of Walbundri. Have you got that? North of Yakandanda, east of Mullingandra and south of Walbundri. Yay! You just learnt some Australian place names. Old Joe woke up. He stretched and he yawned. But before you could say Burrumbuttick, that's another Australian place name, his false teeth jumped out of his mouth and ran down a goanna hole. But old Joe hadn't noticed. He cut himself a bit of bread, put a bit of tomato on it. He'd made himself a sandwich for breakfast. He opened his mouth wide, but,
what's this? I can't get a grip on my breakfast sandwich. What's happened to me teeth?
He looked everywhere. He looked in his sleeves. He looked in his pockets. He even looked in the nearby goanna hole. But teeth can be very, very quiet when they're hiding in a goanna hole.
I know what I've done. I think I must have swallowed me teeth. That's what I've done. I swallowed them in the night when I was snoring. Yeah.
So he tipped himself up, gave himself a good shake, and while he was upside down, his teeth shot out from that goanna hole and ran off down the road. Oh, Joe, he couldn't believe it. He said,
"Oi, oi, you get back in my mouth where you belong."
But the false teeth were very cheeky. They called back, "Yakety yak, snickety snack. I'm tickety boo, you big ganoo." Can you say that? "I'm tickety boo, you big ganoo." Good on you. And down the road they ran. I'm doing running sounds on my legs. Down the road they ran with old Joe in hot pursuit. Now, those teeth were hungry because they hadn't had any breakfast, and they could smell something cooking in Mrs. O'Sullivan's kitchen. Can you guess what it is? You're right. It was a double cream sponge cake with strawberries on top. Before you could say barumbatic, those teeth flew through the air and chomp. Mrs. O'Sullivan's cream cake was gone. "What do you think you're doing, you cheeky teeth? You give me back my cream cake right now." But those teeth just laughed. "Yakety yak, snickety snack. Ready? Tickety boo, you big ganoo." And down the road they ran with old Joe and Mrs. O'Sullivan chasing after. But those teeth were still hungry. They could smell something else. Mr. Blandowski had been to the market, and he bought himself something for lunch. Oh, can you guess what it is? Can you guess? What is it? What is it? It was a fish. A fish. Well, before you could say barumbatic, those teeth flew through the air and... chomp! Mr. Blandowski's fish was gone. "What do you think you are doing, you cheeky teeth? You give me back my fish right now." But the teeth just laughed. "Yakety yak, snickety snack. Tickety boo, you big ganoo." And down the road they ran with old Joe, Mrs. O'Sullivan, and Mr. Blandowski in hot pursuit. But the teeth were still hungry. Now, I know that at this point in the story, some of you are asking, where does the teeth put all that food? Because teeth don't seem to have a stomach. Well, the thing is, Joe's false teeth, old Joe's false teeth, had hollow legs. So that's where all the food was going. Those teeth were running along. They could smell. Ooh, Jacamara was taking something off the barbecue. What had he had on the barbecue that the teeth could smell cooking? What do you think it was? Can you tell? Maybe you need to see a bit more. There it is. It was a chicken. Jacamara was roasting a chicken. In Australia, we often say chook. He was just about to take it off that barbecue, but before you could say barumbatic, those teeth flew through the air and chomp. Jacamara's roast chook was gone. "Oh, what are you doing? You give me back my roast chook right now, you cheeky teeth." But they just laughed. "Yakety yak, snickety snack. Tickety boo, you big ganoo." And down the road they ran with old Joe, Mrs. O'Sullivan, Mr. Blandowski, and Jacamara in hot pursuit. Oh, no. Oh, no. I was still hungry. They could smell something Mrs. Takahashi was cooking in her kitchen. Can you guess? Well, yes, like a kebab. But Mrs. Takahashi, she's from Japan, and she calls this chicken yakitori. She was standing in the kitchen, turning the chicken yakitori under the griller. La-di-da-di-da-di-da. Before you could say barambatek, those teeth flew through the air and chomp. Mrs. Takahashi's chicken yakitori was gone. Oh, you cheeky teeth. You give me back my chicken yakitori right now. But the teeth just laughed. Ha ha ha. Yakety yak, snickety snack. Tickety bow, you big gnu. And down the road they ran with old Joe, Mrs. O'Sullivan, Mr. Blandowski, Jakamara, and Mrs. Takahashi in hot pursuit. Meanwhile, back at the camp, someone woke up. Who was still back at the camp? Split Dog. Where's old Joe? What's happened to him? He should be here at the camp having his breakfast. Oh no. Maybe he's got lost or worse. Maybe he's been Joe-napped. Split Dog spun around the camp, trying to pick up old Joe's scent. Oh, that'd be old Joe. And off he went. Really fast. And soon he could see what was going on. Those runaway false teeth being chased by all those very annoyed people. Oh no, they're not going to be able to catch those teeth. They're way too fast. I'm going to need to come up with a very cunning plan. Light bulb idea. Split Dog had a brilliant plan. He knew that those teeth really liked sweet things. So he went off looking for a nest of honeybees. He got a big batch of honey, put it in a pot, and stirred it to make super sticky honey toffee. How would a dog stir a big pot of sticky honey toffee, with his nose? You think he stirred the honey with his nose? No. With his paws? Well, he would have got very sticky, messy paws. Yes. He stirred with his tail. He stirred and he stirred and he stirred. He stirred and he stirred and he stirred. And he tested. And he stirred and he stirred and he stirred until it was just right. Or was it just right? Would you like to have a taste? Yeah, have a taste. Can you taste? That's his tail. Oh, there. And when it was just right, Split Dog sat down by the side of the road like a honey trap, and he waited like this with his tail up like this. Nothing moved except his eyes. He waited, and then down the road they came. Yakety yak, snippety snack. Oh, sticky honey toffee. Before you could say barambatic, those teeth flew through the air and jump. Split Dog said, "Arr! The Teeth said, They were well and truly caught. And that's the story of how Split Dog outwitted Old Joe's runaway false teeth. That's one of my favorite stories. It might have reminded you of another story, maybe. What about the gingerbread man? Did it remind you of the gingerbread man? Oh, maybe not. Before I close up the Kamishibai, let's have a look. I've got a few more puzzles in here for you. Let's see how you go. So this one, we've got a P, plus an I, so P plus I. And that, I told you I'm not a brilliant drawer. I might have to tell you, it's a rat. So P plus I plus rat. What do you think that might be? Oh, I think some of you have got it. I thought I'll just sit here and have a cup of tea while you work it out. But no, you're too quick. Here we go. Drum roll. Pirate. Did you get it? Don't worry if you didn't get it. I'm sure I wouldn't be any good at these. The only reason I'm good at these is because I made them. I've got one more here, one more. Now this one is a little bit trickier because there is a minus sign. So this is a tie plus girl, so tie girl, but you have to take away the L. Tie plus girl, take away the L. You've got it, and you've got it, and you've got it, and you've almost got it, haven't you? You've almost got it, but it's just, it's coming. You ready? Drum roll. There it is, tiger. Did you get it? Did you? So that's it for the stories. So how are you going there, Sujit? Are you enjoying my stories?
Before you can say barom batek, you gave me so many wonderful expressions now.
You've learned some Australian place names now.
Yes. So I was trying out those place names. I found very difficult. Could you say that east of? I can't get it now.
Yakandanda. Yes. Well, you know, I find Indian place names hard, and a lot of Australian place names are from First Nations languages, Aboriginal languages. So there were many languages in Australia before colonization, maybe, you know, 250, 300 languages and dialects, and a lot of landscape holds those names in memory. Very, very beautiful, languages and beautiful names.
Are the languages still in circulation? Do people still speaks.
Yes, they do. Many of the languages have been lost, but there's also been a lot of language reclamation work going on. You know, people studying the languages, going through histories and finding the languages. But certainly there are some parts of Australia where First Nations languages are the languages that are spoken above English. Yeah. So they're wonderful languages.
You know, same in India. We have so many tribes. You know, children.
Sorry about that. We are having a bit of technical problems. So we will switch it on. We'll get back soon enough. Just give us a couple of seconds.
Yes. Oh, you could make some wonderful Kamishibai stories from those. Absolutely. Yeah. Sure, be inspired. Sure. Be inspired. So,
definitely. Now, children, I'm sorry I took your time of asking questions because it's already late in Australia. Can you guess what it is now? It's almost like 2:30 in the morning. So today we will not be having the question answer session because after Jackie finishes her presentation on Australia, you know, we have the thing that we are all waiting for, the stories, you know, the story told by children, right? So that we'll be featuring, but so stay tuned, keep waiting for that. But before that, Jackie has some wonderful things. She gave me a sneak peek into some of them. So, Jackie, why don't you tell us about Australia with your treasure trove?
I thought, now I could have made a PowerPoint and shown you photographs, but I thought I would share you something more personal, something from my life and what it was like for me growing up in Australia and some of the things I love. Now, when I was little, when I was about 6 years old, I was given a toy. Didn't have a lot of toys. You don't need a lot of toys, really, do you? Anything can be a toy. But this, I just loved. I loved it so much that I still have it. See if you can guess what it is. It's a koala. It's about the size, I suppose, of a young koala. An adult would be, we'd be twice the size. But to me, this koala was absolutely real. It didn't have a name like, I don't know, Freddie or Mary or Bertie. It was always just koala. And I love the way I could hold it like this and cuddle it. And it's very, very soft. And you can see that it doesn't have any eyes. It used to have two beautiful glass eyes, but long, long ago they got lost. And I suppose I could have taken koala somewhere to get new eyes, but I thought, no, losing of the eyes is all part of its story and part of it getting old. So I wanted to show you that. That was given to me when I was 6 years old, and I still have it. I don't have many things from when I was that age. So you can work out how old I am now. Are you ready to do the maths on this? I've had this koala for 60 years, and I got it when I was 6 years old. So I had a love of Australian animals from a very, very early age. Now, the other thing that we have in Australia, things that we have, birds, animals, birds. We have birds. We have the most amazing birds. I think you have pretty amazing birds in India too. Well, of course, I can't show you the birds. I could have shown you photographs. But instead of that, I am going to show you some of their feathers. And you can see how beautiful their feathers are. Lean across there. Now, the reason I decided to wear black tonight, I thought, well, I'm going to disappear into this black background, but I thought that doesn't matter because I wanted you to be able to see these feathers. And I thought if I wear black, you'll be able to, oops, I'm trying to get that in front of the camera. There we go. That is the tail of a red black tail feather, not the tail, the tail feather of a red-tailed black cockatoo. Beautiful black, glossy black cockies. That's the male. That's the male's feathers. Oh, now you can see. I was trying to keep those, so you couldn't see them. And they're the females. So that's the male feathers, and that's the female feathers. Now, these birds used to be quite common, and like a lot of animals around the world, they're becoming less and less common as their habitat is encroached upon by us humans. And these were picked up from the side of a road. There'd been a flock of cockatoos by the side of the road. When they took off and flew off into the sky, we found some feathers, so I feel very, very fortunate to have those. I value them. They're quite old. But the other feather I wanted to show you, I know in India you have the beautiful peacock, but we have a bird. It's called a lyrebird. Whoops. And this is a lyrebird feather. It's hard for me to show. There you go. It's not as the lyrebird, L-Y-R-E, is not as big as a peacock. It's a bit smaller, but it's still, with its tail, it's quite a largish bird, like a big chicken, like a big round chicken. And this is one of its feathers. I actually wrote a story. We're talking about books before. I wrote a story about a lyrebird. They're famous for their mimicry. They can mimic anything. They can mimic every bird song in the forest, cars. There was one in a sanctuary for a long time, and before digital cameras, it had learnt to imitate the sound of the camera and the rewinding of the film. Car sirens. That one also used to do a car siren. They're absolutely beautiful birds. And we were talking about books before. And I've written a few books. So I'm just going to show you one of the books I wrote was, in fact, about the first lyrebird that was filmed and recorded in display. It's a bit hard to see all my ring lights making a funny. There you can just see that's what the lyrebird looks like in display. So it doesn't put its feathers up like a peacock. It puts them right over its head like that. Absolutely beautiful birds. In the back of this book, there are lots of Australian birds. There, I'll just hold that up there. You can see the lyrebird down the bottom there. And we have these beautiful parrots. And that one there, I'm doing this back to front, it's hard to see. That one there is a black cockatoo, but that's a yellow-tailed black cockatoo, not a red-tailed one. So they're the birds. I wanted to show you the feathers. The other thing I wanted to mention was go back to my map of Australia. Now, I've lived all around Australia. I was born here in Melbourne. And then I went to school for a while up here in another state called Queensland. Went to school in the city there called Brisbane. And then I studied in New South Wales in Sydney. Then I lived in the desert. Then I lived in South Australia. And then I lived in Western Australia. Now, apart from the time I lived in the middle of Australia, where it's hot and dry, I've always lived around the coast. So I love things from the sea. I'm fascinated by things from the sea. And when I was little, we used to quite commonly collect these on the beaches. Beautiful, beautiful shells. There's one I've collected. There's another one. But times have changed. These days we say when you go to the beach, what do we say? Leave only footprints, take only pictures. So I wouldn't go to the beach today and pick up shells. I would look at them and admire them, but I would leave them on the beach. Because some of these shells, you know, they become homes for, even though these shells had no animals in them when I picked them up, if I'd left them, they might have made a home for maybe a hermit crab. Who knows? And there's one more shell in here. I loved shells so much. I was given money to buy an ice cream. I can remember. I was about 8 years old.
Jackie is having some problems with the internet. We are really sorry. I mean, my laptop went on a update at that time, but that's how technology is. And so I had to sign out. But thank you very much, Jackie. It was wonderful having you. Unfortunately, it's already 10 o'clock now. And you know what is the time in Australia right now? It's 2:30 in the middle of the night. Okay, so anyway, we had a lovely session with Jackie, and now the most important thing that all of you have been waiting for. So we, as I told you earlier, we had this lottery at the beginning of the session. Those of you who joined later, just to let you know, from today we are starting this new feature in Storytime at 9 called Tiny Tellers, Mighty Tales, in which we're going to be featuring stories told by children. Okay, and this is from partner schools. So the schools have sent in selected some videos from children and sent it to us. So today, we determined by lottery that it is BJEM School 2 in Bhubaneswar, which is going to be featured today. Okay, so from next Saturday, BJEM 2 will not be in the lottery, but other schools. New schools would be added. We had only 6 schools in the lottery today. The other 5 schools will remain in the lottery, and we'll add other schools as well. Okay, and one of the videos from BJEM School is going to be played now on Storytime at 9. But both the videos will go up on the YouTube channel. So all the entries from the school will go up on the Bakul Foundation YouTube channel under a new playlist called Tiny Tellers, Mighty Tales. You know that, right? So today, we have two candidates or two videos from two children from BJEMS school, Aditi Das of class 7 and Suvali Patnaik. So let us see, Computer G, who is it going to be today? Aditi Das or Suvali Patnaik? Okay. And it is Aditi Das. So congratulations, Aditi. I hope you're seeing this. And now we will play your video, your storytelling video. But then, Suvali, your video will go up on the YouTube channel along with Aditi's. And for those of you from BJEMS school whose storytelling videos were not talked about today, please don't be disappointed. It is much later in life that I started telling stories. The most important thing is if you started telling stories yourself, if you started recording yourself, please do that. It does not matter. Please create your own YouTube channels. Okay, please feel free to share your storytelling videos with us. But as I said, here there are limitations. Okay, so right now, Aditi from BJEMS school. Let me play that.
One, I am Aditi Das of Class 7, Section C from Bakshi Jagabandhu English Medium School 2. Today, I am going to tell you a story. And the title of my story is The Secret Weapon. It was the eve of Halloween, a night just before the New Year in Hawaii. Kids were roaming here and there discussing about the characters they are going to be on the Halloween's eve. When a small child, a little boy comes, the children ask him, "Hey, what are you going to be on the Halloween's eve? Which thing spooks you the most?" The little boy said, "Nothing spooks me. I'm not afraid of anything." The children were not ready to agree to this thing. They started arguing with the child. Between this argument, the little child saw a small shadow near the bush. The shadow grew into two shoes, then into two long legs with shoulders on the side, and a big face with curved chin, curved nose, big button eyes, and black long hairs. The man came near the boy and said, "Are you the boy who isn't afraid of anything?" The boy said, "Sometimes, I'm sometimes afraid, otherwise I'm not, yeah." At that time, the tall, long-legged man said, "If you are not afraid of anything, follow me." Then the man started walking with his long legs, but the child had to rush behind him to match his steps. They went left, right, right, left, here, there, here, and finally they reached an end of a long street. The man turned back and said, "Are you still here, little boy?" The boy said, "Yes, I am still here." Then the man pushed his hands through the opening of an ivy and he entered the ivy. The child did the same, proving that he is not afraid of anything or anyone. Soon he went and reached an area filled with stones that had numbers and characters and letters written on them. Soon he realized that he was in a graveyard. Oh my God! But still, the tall man was walking and walking and walking towards a door. They both pushed the door and entered the area while a flock of bats rushed out of the room just above the head of the little child. Wah! The child got scared. Now the person asked him, "Are you afraid, little boy?" The boy replied, "No, I'm not." Then the man again repeated his words, If you are not afraid, follow me. Then the man went to a darker place. That place was so dark that the boy was barely able to see his own hands. In that room, some noises of something getting torn was to be heard. The child was asked by the tall man again the same question. Are you afraid, little boy? The boy replied as usual, no, no way, I'm not afraid. And then he again asked him to follow him. Then he went through the stairs. And he went to even a darker place. The place was so dark that the child couldn't see his own hands at all while his hand is in front of his face. And at that time, the person asked him, are you afraid, little boy? In a frightening manner. At the same time, sounds were to be heard as if stones under the earth were getting crushed with each other. Now the child got afraid and he admitted, yes, I am afraid. I admit that I am afraid. I'm freaked out and you are too spooky. And sometime the child realized as if he was in trouble. He used his secret weapon. He tightened his fists and concentrated and a sound came. A stinky smell spread all around the room to the graveyard out of the ivy. And the man fell unconscious. The little child escaped that area and went to his friends. His friends started teasing him. Na 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 na. We saw you getting frightened by the tall man. Yay! The child admitted, yes, I agree that I got frightened by the man. But do you know, I used my secret weapon to escape from the area. Secret weapon? The children thought of it. Because he didn't take even a small weapon while going, they asked in curiosity, what is the secret weapon? The child tightened his fists, concentrated, and again a sound came out. He shared his secret weapon with all his friends. Thank you.
Well, that was wonderful. Thank you very much, Aditi. Love the storytelling. But as I said, children, keep telling stories. Keep recording yourself, right? And you know what you're supposed to do. I didn't have any time to say that. Unfortunately, we could not say a proper goodbye to Jackie. But then, if you like the videos, what are you supposed to do? Now, you must be knowing that by now already. You're supposed to share, subscribe, and like, right? Share the video, subscribe to the YouTube channel, and like the Facebook page. I mean, depending on wherever you're seeing it, okay? So, and as I said, Aditi's video and Suvali's video will be up on YouTube on the Bakul Foundation channel. So far, I know some of you told me that I didn't give a clue as to the country that we'll travel to next time. So season 2 must have some things new, right? So I'm not going to give you a clue again. Keep watching the space for the update of which country we are traveling to next Saturday. And next Saturday, again, we'll have a lottery to decide which school it will be. That will be featured in the next Saturday. And which child will be featured, right? Okay, then. See you. Bye-bye. Good night. And in Orissa, we are enjoying the rains. So enjoy that. Thank you very much.
As sly as a fox, as strong as an ox, as fast as a hare, as brave as a bear, as free as a bird, as neat as a word, as quiet as a mouse, as big as a house. I wanna be. as a wolf, as sharp as a tooth, as deep as a bite, as dark as the night, as sweet as a song, as right as a wrong, as long as a road, as ugly as a toad, as pretty as a picture hanging from a fixture, strong like a family, strong as I wanna be, bright as day, as light as plane, as hard as nails, as grand as a whale. All I wanna be, oh, all I wanna be, oh, all I wanna be is everything. As the sun, as silly as fun, as cool as a tree, as scary as the sea, as hot as fire, cold as ice, sweet as sugar and everything nice, as old as time, as straight as a line, as royal as a queen, as buzzed as a bee, as stealth as a tiger, smooth as a glider, pure as a melody, pure as I wanna be. Oh,